Hi, this is Pastor Dan Kramer from Zion Christian Church in Pittsburgh. This program will give you a glimpse into the life of an amazing group of people who are seeing God do tremendous things. We trust that you're encouraged by our rich worship service and the ministry of God's Word. We'd love to have you visit with us here some Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. We'd love to make you welcome, and I know the Holy Spirit would encourage you. We take time in His presence to enjoy Him. Love to have you do that with us here at Zion Christian Church.
Come to worship you, Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We have an everlasting God that's worthy of our praises. Amen. Isn't He worthy?
We wait.
you say I'm a friend of God? Can you say it out loud? I'm a friend of God. Help me out, Dennis. Oh, it's so good to be in the Lord's house today. To worship Him and give Him praise. You are worthy, Jesus, of all our praises. Now I'm going to fill this place with praises to the King of Kings.
Thank you.
to know somebody in high places, and I don't think you're going to get any higher in the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, you have somebody in high places that you know. Oh, God, it's good to be called your friend. Yes, it is, Lord. Good to be called a friend of the Lord. And that's what he says. He said that he calls us friends. So, Lord, we stand before you gracefully broken just because of your Holy Spirit. Yeah, Holy Spirit that gives us oil. It gives us that joy for everything that comes in our life. That comforter. We call upon your great name. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Let us feel your comforter today.
Set me on fire. Take all I have in my hands and all.
God breaks us. He breaks us so gently. And His Holy Spirit is such a good teacher. He always says, our best interests at heart. He gives life, He gives hope. He gives the next breath that we breathe. That's a gift from God, that breath that you breathe, the next breath. Breath of life. Thank you.
Thank you.
Just pour your love on the Lord today. Just pour it out. You know, God pours his love out on us. You know, sometimes we just got to be still and just drink in of his holy presence. Your life gets so busy. Sometimes it's just good to take a drink of that living water, isn't it? So drink in today. Can you receive? Can you feel the Comforter touch you today? I believe when we worship God and we're around other people, they know that we were with the Almighty God. Because you know what? We can't go and worship God without being changed.
God. Well, today, as we come to God's Word, I'd like to think about the cross. And it's going to be talking today about rediscovering the cross. And the cross is so central to Christianity. The cross, and actually what happened on the cross, of course, which was Christ dying in our place. And I'd like to go back to begin. I know that my slide up there says Galatians 6:14, but I'd like to go to a different passage from the book of Isaiah, which was written many hundreds of years before Jesus ever was born, and outlined so much about what happened on that cross. In Isaiah chapter 53, we could read the entire chapter, but I'm going to begin just for the sake of time in talking from verse 8. And it says there, "By oppression and judgment he was taken away. As for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living for the transgression of my people to whom the stroke was due?" I mean, what an amazing prophecy about Jesus. I mean, hundreds and hundreds of years before he was born. They didn't believe that he was, cut off out of the living for the transgression of God's people. His grave was assigned with wicked men, yet was with a rich man in his death. And we know that they assigned Jesus a common grave that was there for the criminals, but at the same time, a rich man, Joseph of Arimathea, came along and offered his upgrade to Jesus. And just these details that were written just so many hundreds of years before they happened. I mean, no one could make this up. I mean, this is right here and it's provable. "Because he had done no violence, neither was there any deceit in his mouth. But the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to death, grief, if he would render himself as a guilt offering." And here it comes talking about the resurrection. "He will see his offspring. He will prolong his days, and the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand." You know, when I get discouraged, I remind myself sometimes that the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in the hands of Jesus. And guess who else is in the hands of Jesus? We are. Isn't that wonderful? It's great to know. You know, we're not orphans in this universe. We have a God who cares about us and holds us in his hand. "As a result of the anguish of his soul, he, the Father, will see it and be satisfied. By his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will justify the many as he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he will divide the booty with the strong, because he poured himself out to death. He was numbered with the transgressors, yet he himself bore the sin of many and interceded for the transgressors." This was written about Jesus, something like 800 years before he was physically born on the earth. It was part of this stream of prophecy about his coming that began in the Garden of Eden and came to a climax upon the cross and the resurrection. And, as we think about that, he was numbered with the transgressors. He never had a transgression. He never sinned, but he was numbered with the transgressors. You know, if you could imagine, on the judgment day, if you could imagine and just say if God the Father had categorized people, and all the sinful people get over here, and you're looking, oh yeah, they deserve to be there. They deserve to be there. But wait a minute, what? That's Jesus. Why is he there? He was numbered with them, but he didn't sin. He doesn't deserve to be there. But he was there for our place, to take our place. All the murderers are over here, and you're looking, yeah, that guy, they committed murder. They deserve to be there. But wait a minute, why is Jesus numbered with them? He's so holy. He's so pure. He's numbered with them to take their place, to take the penalty that was brought upon them by their own actions. That's why he's numbered with them. That's the grace of God. That's the mercy of Jesus bearing the penalty that we deserved. And when we think about Christ going to the cross, I love this verse that the Apostle Paul wrote. from Galatians chapter 6. But may it never be. You know, I don't want to tell you, if any Christian had a reason to boast, it was the Apostle Paul. I mean, this guy was a revival that changed the world. But he says this, but may it never be that I would boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Paul said, may it never be. And sometimes, you know, when we are discouraged with ourselves, you know, Corey Ten Boom said, look without and be distressed. Look within and be depressed. Look at him and be at rest. And that's kind of like what we have to do with the cross. You know, we can look at the circumstances in life. I don't know about you, but sometimes I have some very hard ones in my life, and it can get discouraging, and I know that you do too. So we look without, and we can be distressed. Then we look within, you know, God, why aren't I responding better? What, you know, why am I? But then we look at the cross, and we know that it's okay, that the price was paid there, that Jesus did it all there. And whether I feel like it or not, it was accomplished and it was finished there. No matter how I feel, no matter how my body feels, no matter how my brain feels, you know, no matter what it looks like, we come to the cross and we look at Christ crucified and we know that he who provided forgiveness for our sins is not going to drop us now. He's not. And we build up our confidence. Paul said that. And you know, there's a very interesting story in the Bible around the cross about this man called Barabbas. Some of you, many of you are familiar. But this had to do, and I'm going to read from Luke chapter 23. It says in Luke chapter 23, verse 23, but they were insistent. They're in front of Pilate demanding that Christ be crucified now. They were insistent with loud voices asking that he be crucified, and their voices began to prevail. And Pilate pronounced sentence that their demand be granted, and he released the man they were asking for who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, but he delivered Jesus to their will. There's this man named Barabbas. I mean, here's Christ who was sinless. All he ever did was heal people. All he ever did was love people. Of course, he got the religious people upset because he upset their apple cart because what they were believing and saying wasn't really right. They were upset with him, but he never did anything wrong. And there was this chorus of cries to crucify Christ. And it says their voices began to prevail. What that word means in the Greek language that the Bible was written in, there was this wild swirling of loud voices, that there was this tornado of cries that Christ be crucified. So Pilate's sitting there, he's a Roman governor, he's a strong man, he's not going to cave in to the demands of people, but he did on this occasion. And he tried four different times to avoid passing the sentence of death upon Jesus. The first time they came in John 19, he told them, you deal with it yourself. You have your own ways, you deal with it yourself. Then he tried to refer the whole thing to King Herod. Herod sent him back. He tried to persuade the Jews to receive Jesus as the prisoner granted at the release of the Passover time. And that was when they chose Barabbas. I mean, what he did was he picked the least likely person that they would ever choose to be released. When it came to Jesus or someone else, Barabbas was notorious, the Bible says. He was a notorious prisoner. He was a murderer. He was a bandit. And Pilate picked someone that he thought, there's no way they're going to pick him over Jesus. But this wild swirl, this tornado of crucify him, crucify him, he backed down and he chose Barabbas. Barabbas was notorious, a murderer, a abandoned. And yet there's a little picture in there of what the death of Jesus really accomplished. The death of Jesus set the murderer free, and the sinless one went to the cross. And there's this little picture in there of the power of what Jesus actually came to do. This undeserving man got set free. Do you know what? I'm an undeserving person. I don't deserve the mercy of God in my life. You're an undeserving person. You don't deserve the mercy of God in your life. But isn't that the marvel of it? That's the amazing thing about it. We can't deserve it. We will never earn it. We cannot do enough good works to deserve God's favor to rest upon us. But we also don't have to, because God chose to send his Son into this world to take our place and bear the sins that we deserved his judgment for, so that we could go free, just like Barabbas went free. Now, I've never done the things that Barabbas has done, but I've sinned, and you have all sinned. We have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. But Christ came. And we need to remind ourselves of the power of that cross. The power of that cross where Jesus died. 1 Peter says this, chapter 3, 18, "For Christ also died for sins once for all, the just for the unjust, so that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit." Romans 5, 8, "But God demonstrates his own love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." So when you read the story or you hear the story of Barabbas, remind yourself, as unfair as it was, there was a picture in there that Christ came to die to set the guilty free. And how many of you know we all have reason to give thanks to God for that? Because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, except for one, Jesus. There's another thing that happened on that as that cross unfolded. A tremendous story about the thief on the cross who came to faith in Christ as he was dying there. And you know, it says in Luke chapter 22, verse 37, as Christ was going to Jerusalem, he said this, "For I tell you that this which is written must be fulfilled in me, and he was numbered with the transgressors. For that which refers to me has its fulfillment." So as he's going to Jerusalem to die, he's quoting out of Isaiah 53 that we read. It has to be fulfilled that he was numbered with the transgressors. Well, when was that fulfilled? It was fulfilled most literally when Christ died between two thieves. And as we know the story, they crucified Jesus, and there was a thief that was on either side of him. John chapter 19, verse 18. There they crucified him, and with him two other men, one on either side and Jesus in between. So here's one thief being crucified. Christ is in the middle being crucified. A second thief is being crucified beside him. And Mark's gospel puts it like this. In Mark chapter 15, verse 27 and 28, they crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, and he was numbered with the transgressors. I mean, even that detail was pre-told. Even that detail was told about Christ being numbered with the transgressors, Christ being placed between two thieves upon the cross as he was crucified. And isn't that an amazing thing? You know, both these thieves at the very beginning were giving Jesus a hard time. They were being crucified themselves. Matthew chapter 27, verse 44, "And the robbers who had been crucified with him were also insulting him with the same words. Now from the sixth hour, darkness fell on all the land until the ninth hour." So those two thieves both started insulting him. But something happened. When Christ was upon the cross, he prayed a prayer. I don't think people were used to hearing prayers from people being crucified. They were used to hearing oaths and curses and groans and moans. That's what they were used to hearing. They were used to hearing vindictive language towards those who would put them there. You know, that crucifixion was illegal for someone who wasn't a Roman. It was illegal for a Roman. It was a death. It was the worst possible death that you could die in those days and in those times. It was torturous. It was horrible. And that's the death that Jesus died. And as he's there, and he's on that cross, and there's these two thieves, and everyone's mocking him in front of him. And these two thieves are mocking him from either side. And as he's praying, he prays this prayer, and he says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Who prays like that when they're being killed, tortured? And it's the whole charges are trumped up and lied about. There's only one person who prays like that, and that's our Savior. And you know, the Bible tells us that after he prayed that prayer, one of the two thieves turned to him and said to him, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." I mean, what an outrageous looking request. Here's Jesus, who's obviously dying a horrible death upon this cross. Here's him who's dying a horrible death right beside him. But he saw something in the Son of God that gave him confidence that this was not the end of the picture. This was not the final thing. That somehow Christ was a king and he was going to come into his kingdom. And he begins to say to the other thief in the same passage, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we're indeed suffering justly. We're receiving what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." What changed him? All I can tell you is the cross changes people. It changes the direction of people. Maybe not everyone, but for those who are willing and those who are open and those who can see what God intended, it will change your life forever. And it'll not only change your life forever, it'll change your life for all eternity. When my mother was dying in 2012, I did a Bible study. I looked up and wrote down every single verse in the Bible that talked about heaven and eternal life. And I was surprised. I mean, even though I've been a Christian and I believe all this, I was surprised how much the Bible actually says about heaven. There's a ton of stuff in there. And you know what? It's all good. And the cross takes me, who is a sinner, and places me in that place that is perfect, because of what Jesus did upon that cross. Now, can you imagine, none of his disciples who had followed him around, none of his disciples who had seen the miracles and the healings that had taken place, none of the disciples who saw him bring back the dead said to him as he was on the cross — they weren't anywhere near the cross, they were hiding because they were afraid. And we probably would have been too if we'd have been in the same position. But can you imagine, none of them said to him, "Lord, remember me when you come into their kingdom." They thought it was over. But here's this thief who never followed him ever, right beside him, being crucified. And he sees something in the Son of God that makes him know there's more to this man than meets the eye. And this man has done nothing wrong. And he says, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Today you will be with me in paradise." I don't know about you, but that's stunning. What did he see in Jesus? that awoke within him that realization that there's more to this than meets the eye. And somehow in the midst of things that we don't understand, God is right on track. And I want to tell you, if you're in a position in your life where there's things happening that you don't understand, you can have the confidence that even though you don't understand them, you wish it wasn't like that. You wouldn't wish it on your worst enemy. God is still on track. And we worship him. You know, Jesus saying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Just think if all of us had that heart right away, you know. We might get there. But just think if we had it while the offense was happening. Father, forgive. You know, and it's, in a sense, you know, in one sense, they knew exactly what they were doing. But in another sense, they had no idea what they were doing. And when we're in a situation where there's been offense, and when we've been hurt, something has really happened that has knocked us down. Just think if we could pray that way. Father, forgive them. Even though they know exactly what they're doing, they don't know what they're doing. You know, forgive them, Lord. I think we'd get through life a little easier. But it's the power of the cross that changed that thief, something about it. And you know, it's good for us to reflect upon what Christ did at that cross in our lives and to not venture too far away from that. Even the soldiers were demonstrated awe in the death of Jesus. You know, when he did die, okay, here they are, 1, 2, 3, right? Thief, Jesus, thief. The soldiers came to one thief and broke his legs. They broke the legs because you had to push yourself up to breathe. If you can't push yourself up to breathe, you suffocate. So they come to the first soldier, they break his legs, and he dies. They skip Jesus and they go to the other thief and they break his legs. He can't breathe. He dies. They come back in the middle to Jesus. I mean, this is the awe that they're having of this guy. He's up there on that cross. The sky turns dark. He shouts, "It is finished." Graves open up in the city of Jerusalem. I mean, that's why the centurion said, "Surely this is the Son of God." He's like, "What have we done? We've crucified the Son of God." All these things are taking place. Coming to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead and they didn't break his legs. And you know, it had been...
This is Pastor Dan Kramer from Zion Christian Church. I want to thank you for watching this video of our worship service. God is on the move and we are so thankful. I'd love to invite you to join us Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock here at Zion Christian Church. I know that you would be encouraged by our worship and the ministry of God's Word. It's a wonderful group of people to be connected to. Why not join us this Sunday at Zion Christian Church? God bless you.